We began our first service today with the baptism of two adults. Now we have a child who's professing his faith in Christ for us today. Zachary Moutre is 8 years old, and we've known him every day of his life as he's lived among us. I was at the hospital with Pastor Kim, I guess the day after he was born, and we've taken great interest in this young man, and now he's given his life to Christ. Zach Moutre, who is Jesus to you?
He is my Lord.
Zachary, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Lord, we've done as you've commanded, and still there is room.
I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you always, even to the very end of the age. I am working all things for your good. I will withhold no good thing from you. I am your shield and your great reward. I am your light and your salvation. I am the stronghold of your life. I will give you eternal life. I will give you abundant life. I will give you peace. I will give you rest. I will give good gifts to those who ask me, and I will give strength to the weary, power to the weak. I am close to the brokenhearted, and I will comfort those who mourn. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I will hear you, forgive you, and heal you. I will be found by those who seek me. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will do whatever you ask in my name. I will listen to you. I will fight for you. I will set you free, and I will not change. I will redeem your life from the pit and crown you with love and compassion. I will finish the good work I have begun in you. I will never blot your name out of the book of life. I will come back and take you to be with me. I will deliver you, and you will honor me.
Would you stand? Let's worship the one who gave us those promises and let him know how much we love him, and that we worship him.
Keeps us. We
love the Lord Jesus. And we love the fact that all of you are here this morning. Take just a moment to look around and welcome those around you this morning. Welcome to worship. Please be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. I'm so glad to see you. I've missed the last three Sundays, and I missed you a great deal. It's good to be back. I had a stroke, you know, but I'm doing better. I'm almost well, and we'll see how it goes today. But thank you for coming, and if you're our guest, a special welcome to you. We hope you feel at home here and that you'll want to come back again and again. I want to pause and thank you for your prayers and your cards and visits and food and all of that. I want to thank Brian Jones for stepping in at the literal last minute to preach, and then Reed Burnick to preach the last two Sundays. And speaking of Reed, he's bringing a family member to dedicate today. Reed, you want to come on up here? And Bridget? And Edith? Edith, you know, but there's a precious new baby, Margaret Vickers Burnick. God has blessed you so much with these wonderful children. And they're they're church favorites because we see them around so much and are delighting in watching them to grow. We did this for you a couple of years ago, I guess, and now it's your sister's turn. Are you promising to raise your child in a Christian home? Are you going to teach her all the ways of Jesus and how to follow him? Will you be demonstrating that in the way you live your lives in front of her? Yeah. And are you going to join with us in prayer and cooperating to help bring all of that about in the future? Well, she wants me to hold her, but we're going to resist that just to maintain a little distancing. Pastor Kim, you have a verse they've selected?
Yes. You all have selected the second epistle of John, verse 6. Margaret, this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love.
Dear God, we thank you for every blessing, especially children, for the joy they bring, the life they bring to our families and to our church. I pray for this one that you will help her to grow up beautiful on the inside and outside. And Lord, make of her a great woman who's going to make a difference in this world. Bless her sister and her parents, and as a Christian family, may they serve you all their days. Through Christ we pray. Amen. God bless you, Margaret. God bless you, Edith.
When we come to the worship service, I often say, who is the audience? Are you the audience? Are we the audience? Is God the audience? It's God. That's who we came to worship. Not one another, not our traditions, not our favorites. Yes, I will give you praise and glorify your name. It's important to remember that there's an audience of one. It's not us. It's the Lord Jesus. That's why we're here today. Would you stand and let's worship together?
Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will. Thank you.
Please be seated.
Before I preach, I want to lead us in prayer for our world. There are a lot of trouble spots and people in difficulty around the world. And because of where our church is located and because of our commitment to worldwide missions, we know a lot of people in distant lands who need our prayers today. Our friend Nabil Costa in Lebanon has asked us to pray for Beirut and for the country of Lebanon. Many of us have been there and seen the great work that's going on, but Lebanon is descending into chaos, and they're losing everything, and they need our prayers to see them through. Then yesterday, the earthquake, devastating earthquake in Haiti, it's taken hundreds of lives and perhaps thousands when it's all said and done. Let's remember the people of Haiti. And then in the last few days, Afghanistan. Perhaps you've been there. Maybe you've served there and you know what's happening there, the chaos and the inevitable fall of Afghanistan. Let's pray for the people, especially those refugees that will be perhaps heading our way in days to come. And then there are the people of our church who have such needs for comfort and for healing, and we want to pray for them. So join me in prayer, please, would you? Father, you've given us the world on our hearts, and we pray for these trouble spots in Lebanon and Haiti and Afghanistan and so many other places where your presence is needed so much. We pray that you would lead the people in charge, those who are trying to make a difference, see them through and give them direction. And for those of our own church who are suffering today, any kind of grief, any sickness, any problems, Lord, you know them all and you know what needs to happen for them. We put them in your hands for your blessing. And we thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do. Now, speak to our hearts through your word and call us to yourself in a deeper commitment than ever before we've known. Through Christ we pray. Amen. I invite you to take your copy of Scripture and turn to the book of Psalms, number 49. Psalm 49. The words are going to be on the screen. But if you have a Bible, take the time to look it up. It's in the middle of the Bible. If you open it right in the middle, you'll come close to Psalm 49. And it's God's word for us today. Hear this, all you peoples. Listen, all who live in this world, both low and high, rich and poor alike. My mouth will speak words of wisdom. The meditation of my heart will give you understanding. I will turn my ear to a proverb. With the harp I will expound my riddle. Why should I fear when evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast of all their great riches. No one can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for them. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough so that they should live on forever and not see decay. For all can see that the wise die, and the foolish and the senseless also perish, leaving their wealth to others. Their tombs will remain their houses forever, their dwellings for endless generations, though they had named lands after themselves. People, despite their wealth, do not endure. They are like the beasts that perish. This is the fate of those who trust in themselves and of their followers who approve their sayings. They are like sheep and are destined to die. Death will be their shepherd, but the upright will prevail over them in the morning. Their forms will decay in the grave, far from their princely mansions. But God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. Do not be overawed when others grow rich, when the splendor of the houses increases. For they will take nothing with them when they die. Their splendor will not descend with them. Though while they live, they count themselves blessed, and people praise you when you prosper, they will join those who have gone before them, who will never again see the light of life. People who have wealth but lack understanding are like the beasts that perish. God's word for God's people today. I don't suppose our society has ever been more polarized than it is today. Distinctions like high and low, rich and poor, wise and foolish. And then you throw in racial differences and political opinions. We are a divided people, and we've built walls of hostility to keep ourselves separate from the other. And yet I've come to know, and I think many of you have too, that in the final analysis, we're all pretty much the same. Physiologically we are. Our bodies, our human bodies, are almost identical. And in other ways too. If you've traveled, and I'm speaking to folks who do a great deal of traveling, if you've traveled, you've seen the similarities, and you have learned that people the world over are pretty much the same. Augustine said, the world is a book, and those who do not travel read only a page. We're similar. At the height of the Cold War, John F. Kennedy, our president at the time, felt it necessary to address the differences that were separating the East from the West, the free world from the communist world. And he was making this point months before he died at American University. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit the same small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's future. And we are all mortal. Yes, indeed. People the world over want the same things: security, freedom, a home, a roof over our heads, peace, a job, education for our children. We're very much alike. And God, this is the point of the psalm, God has something to say to every one of us. Despite apparent differences, God is speaking to us all. If you don't think God has a word for you, what are you doing here today? You're here because you believe that God has something to say to you. Verse 1 could be translated, listen up, don't miss this. Whatever your station in life, high or low, rich or poor, wise or foolish, God wants to say something to us. He speaks to us primarily through His Word. If you want to know what God thinks and what God has to say to you, you'll find it in the pages of Scripture. It's the surest way. Start there with Scripture, and God will speak. Now, sometimes it's a harsh word. Sometimes it's a word of judgment. He speaks against pride and idolatry, certainly. And we'll think God doesn't love us, but He's doing it because He loves us. He wants us to see the error, the road we're on, it's wrong. He wants to correct us. He loves us with an everlasting love. But now listen, sometimes God speaks to us through His kindness. It's not His wrath. It's not a harsh word. He speaks to us through kindness. Romans chapter 2, verse 4. God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance. I mean, you may live a charmed life and you feel very blessed and you think that means that God approves of everything you're doing, that you and God don't have a problem between you, when you may be living far, far away from Him. God's being kind to you. He's being patient with you in order to bring you to repentance. Don't misunderstand it. He wants to lead you gently to Himself. Peter learned this in Acts chapter 10, verse 34. Peter said, "Now I realize that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears Him and does what is right." Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, He causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. You're not going to be able to tell simply by how the sun is shining on you today where you stand with God. He's drawing you to Himself. Now, the brunt of chapter 49, God is addressing the rich. Now you may say, well, that leaves me out. No, you are rich compared to the places we talked about a moment ago when we were praying. You are rich. All of us are rich. God has a particular word for us. In James chapter 5, verse 1, he says, stop listening to the hoarding of your wealth that you have amassed. Listen up, you rich. I have something to say to you. God has something to say to us. We shouldn't be overawed with the wealthy, and we are. If somebody has a mansion they live in, a certain car they drive, if they're known for their great wealth, we're kind of in awe of them. We figure they must be doing something right. Don't be overawed. God has a lot to say to the rich. F. Scott Fitzgerald once said, you know, the rich are different from you and me. And his friend Ernest Hemingway said, yeah, they've got more money. Yeah, that's not all. Jesus says that the rich will find it hard to get into heaven. The rich will find it hard to get into heaven. Rather than wealth being a sign of God's blessing, it may make it harder for you to get to heaven. It doesn't have much to do with money. Money is neutral. It has to do with what money causes to happen in your life. We all worship something. Our choice is in what we choose to worship. And when you're wealthy, you have a tendency to trust in your wealth. He warns about that here. Those who trust in their wealth and boast of their great riches, what they're really doing is trusting in themselves. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. Because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can mortals do to me? When you're wealthy, you trust in that. You don't have any worries. I mean, you don't need to pray the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. You've got that covered. And you're not going to be evicted from your place of residence. You've got that covered. And you trust in yourselves. The rich have it hard to get into heaven because the tendency is to trust in something other than God. And whether you have a lot or a little today, I mean, I want you to prosper. I'd love for you to be wealthy. That could help our work here if you were wealthy. But I'm warning you not to trust in that, not to depend on that. He has a word to the rich, and the word is in verse 10. Look at it. For all can see, and I hope you can see it, that the wise die, that the foolish and the senseless also perish, leaving their wealth to others. The psalm is teaching us that nobody gets out of this life alive. We all die. C.S. Lewis said, wars do not increase the death rate. It is the same in every generation. 100% of us die. And if you live to be 100 or you only come to age 30, you will one day die. There are a group of people I'm reading about, the immortalists, who believe that death should be an option, that death shouldn't be inevitable. And some of these are billionaires, and they're investing a lot of money in ways to prolong life. Now, I don't mean from 80 to 90. We all would be interested in that. But from 90 to 150. Can you imagine living that long? Or 200 years of age? Some people believe that we can do that one day. But it's not going to be soon, because actually life expectancy in the United States went down in 2020. For the first time since World War II, life expectancy actually declined in the United States. It now stands at 77 years of age. Is that shocking? And it's less for minorities. 77 years of age. We can push death off. We can avoid thinking about it, but the scripture says it is appointed unto every person once to die. And Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 2 says, death is the destiny of everyone. The living should take this to heart. It's your destiny. Now he says in the psalm that you can't buy a place in heaven. Facing the reality of death, and you want to live eternally, and you want to go to heaven when you die, it's not going to be a matter of paying money for it. No one can pay for this or pay a ransom for life. It's too costly. Remember the rich man, the rich fool that Jesus describes in Luke chapter 12, the man who had barns, but it wasn't enough, and he said to himself, I'll tear down my barns, and I'll build bigger barns, and then I'll say to the whole soliloquy, he's talking to himself, only about himself, doesn't have a thought for his neighbors. I will tear down my barns, I'll build bigger barns, and then I'll say, take life easy, eat, drink, enjoy life, like you're planning to do when you retire. Just enjoy life. What that man didn't realize, the rich man in Luke 12, was that very night his soul would be required of him. He didn't have years to live. He didn't have decades to live. He had hours to live. And his money couldn't do him any good. And something else, when you die, you can't take your wealth with you. I mean, you've built quite a portfolio, but what's going to happen when you die? Ecclesiastes 5, verse 15 says, everyone comes naked out of the womb. We come naked into this world, and we go out the same way. Meaning we don't take anything with us. People watched the funeral procession of a wealthy man go by, and one said to the other, I wonder how much he left. His friend said, all of it. And you will leave all of it. That's what verse 10 says. Leaving their wealth to others. It's not going to be for you. It's going to be for your wife's second husband. He's going to spend it all. That which you've worked so hard for, planning to enjoy one day, it will go to others. Now listen. Think about the wealth God has given you. What's going to happen to it? Now, you need to take care of your family, certainly. And you need to take care of causes you believe in. But don't forget the kingdom of God. Don't forget having an investment in the work of God that will outlive you and maybe generations. We're meeting in a beautiful building, and maybe you're seeing it for the first time. Every week somebody's here. Long-time members, but they're seeing the church building for the first time in a long time. And it's beautiful, and we're so glad God has given it to us. But we must step up to pay for it. We're well over halfway there, but still got a ways to go. And maybe you weren't involved. You've come to the church recently, and you weren't involved in all of it. We need everybody to be a part, to contribute regularly for this facility. And it's not a monument to any person or a place to be idolized. It is a base for our ministry to the world. From this place, we go out in the community and the world to share Christ. And so it's going to be a part of our church for a long, long time. We must invest. I heard about a man that had invested a lot of money in his church. He was a rich man. He had given a lot of money to his church. And then the Great Depression hit and wiped out whole fortunes, wiped out his fortune. He was walking into church one Sunday, and One of his friends said, I guess you're sorry now you gave all that money to the church. The wealthy man said, no, that's all I've got left. It's still there. It's still serving. I'm still having a part. You can't take wealth with you. You come into the world naked, you'll go out the same. You'll leave it to somebody else. Who are you leaving your wealth to? Now, I said we're all the same, or pretty much the same, and God is speaking directly to the wealthy, and F. Scott Fitzgerald said the wealthy are different from us, and all of that, but I found one way we are all similar. We die. And I've realized that in that death, there is a difference. There's one difference that separates the peoples of the world. And it's not race, and it's not education and wealth and all of that. It's this. Some people die without hope in the world. Some people die without faith and without Christ. And others of us, we come to that moment. We come to that moment filled with hope. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, boy, that's a downer of a sermon. We're all going to die. He must have written that while he was recuperating in ICU. And I want to remind you that this sermon was scheduled to be preached 3 weeks ago. It was already done. But I was in the ICU at 9 o'clock Saturday night, and there was a lone nurse, Sarah, with me. She just had one other patient in ICU down the hall. And so she came in my room every 15 minutes to ask me if I knew who I was and where I was and all that sort of thing. And I told her I was a minister and that I was due to preach within hours, but I'm not going to be able to do it. She said, well, what were you going to preach about? And I said, well, I'm preaching through the Psalms. And she said, well, you can preach to me. Imagine. And we got to talking about this subject, and I went over from memory what I had planned to say, and we talked about death, and I said, I imagine you see a lot of death in your job. And she said, yes. I found out she was a believer and her hope was in Christ. And there's a difference in the way Christian people die. A great difference. We have a different fate. Look down at verse 15. He's talked about how there's no hope and there's nothing that can be done, and then verse 15, but God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. The psalmist says, I'm going to be different. We're going to die, but God is going to redeem me. This is the mountaintop of Old Testament hope, somebody said. You don't see a lot of it in the Old Testament, this idea of everlasting life and about being with God. But you see it here. And he has promised to take us to himself. The scripture says no one can give a ransom for the life of others. It's too costly. There's one exception. Jesus said in the scriptures in Mark chapter 10, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom. There it is. A ransom for many. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but you were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. You cannot buy your way into heaven with money. What takes us into heaven is something more costly than that. The blood of Christ shed for us. And when you believe in him, when you say yes to him, when you trust in him and not money, you receive the free gift of eternal life. Pharaohs, ancient pharaohs in Egypt were buried, you know this, they were buried in great tombs with their wealth surrounding them. And that's why people like to raid those tombs, because there's just unmeasurable wealth. They believed that life went on and that there was another world and they were going and they would need their money when they got there. They'd need the precious jewels, and so they would take them with them. But you can't take it with you. And if you could, it wouldn't be enough. It's the blood of Christ that saves us. Real life is found in relationship with Christ. He has planned for us a place in heaven. John chapter 14, you know it. John chapter 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. It's clear in the New Testament, not so clear in the Old, but a place is prepared for those who trust in Christ. It's God's word for you today. It's why you're here. He arranged for you to come so that you could be reminded that there's not much difference between us, any of us. Some have more than others. Those who have more have a harder time of it than the rest of us. The real difference is when we know Christ. We die differently. We're going to die, but we die differently because of the place He has prepared for us. I want you to pray with me. Would you bow, please? When the service is over, I'm going to be the front. Other pastors are going to be around too. If you would like to talk with me about this, about how you could know Christ for yourself, or how you could join our church. I had two or three people at the last service come up to me and say, I want to do this. If that's you, I'll be here. Step up and let me have a chance to talk with you. Or call this week and we'll arrange a chance to get together. Lord, speak to our hearts. From your word, make the message clear. And may we trust in you with all that we are. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Let's stand.
Let it be said of us that the Lord was our passion, that with gladness we bore every cross we were given, that we fought the good fight, that we finished the course, knowing within us the power of the risen Lord. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. By mercy made holy, by the Spirit made strong. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Till the likeness of Jesus be through us made known. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Let it be said of us, we were marked by forgiveness, we were known by our love, and delighted in meekness, we were ruled by His peace, heeding unity's call, joined as one body, that Christ would be seen by all. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. By mercy made holy, by the Spirit made strong. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Likeness. of Jesus be through us made known. Let the cross be our glory and the Lord be our song.
Please be seated.
Good morning. I'm glad you're here today, and welcome back to Pastor Don. We are so happy that you are improving so well. Let's look at a few things that are coming up. Sanctity of Life Ministries is one of those local partners that does a magnificent work in the area. We are currently conducting a baby bottle offering, all virtual online, to support their work. So you can give online to support them, and I hope you will. Scoop Fest. It's a funny name, but it means free ice cream in the church parking lot on August 28, 2 to 4. And the purpose of it is to mix and mingle FBCA members with the people who live in the neighborhoods around the church. It's a hospitality opportunity for all of us with free ice cream. Ladies, register now for the North Star Women's Conference. It's scheduled for September 11. Jennifer Rothschild and Laura Story are the program personalities. Space is limited, so sign up today. And men, registration is now open for the retreat at the Bishop Claggett Center in Buckystown, Maryland. Colter Weaver is our speaker. Sign up today because there's limited space, and we really want you to be there. I will enjoy spending the weekend with you. Reflecting on Pastor Don's sermon today, let's take our benediction from the words of Apostle Paul in Romans 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Go now in the grace and peace and hope of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Wayne, and thank you again for being here today. It's great to see you, and I hope now you're going to leave and have a great afternoon. Enjoy this day God has given you, and we'll see you next week. I was thinking when Wayne was talking, and I don't know what jarred this, but one of the fellows that came up to me today wanted to talk about joining the church, big guy. His first Sunday was 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I was not here, but the youth choir sang, and maybe some of you are in the youth choir, and Roger, you need to hear this. The youth choir blessed him and ministered deep in his heart, and he's still talking about it now. You just never know what's going to speak to somebody, and you may feel like you're not making much of a difference, but in that man's life, on that day, you made a great difference. Hope you have a great week. God bless us, everyone. Take care.